This is Chuck Cecil with the seventh hour of a 12-hour remembrance of Glenn Miller, a story told by the people who were there on the bandstand and in the recording studios, the musicians, arrangers, and singers who helped Glenn Miller make music and memories.
We worked three, 4 afternoons a week, plus working every night. So it was a good gig, and certainly I enjoyed working for Glenn.
If you're going to make a mistake, make a good one. He wanted to hear it. He didn't want some guy sitting back cooling it, you know.
We really felt that we were the number one band.
Yester Thoughts, featuring vocalist Ray Eberle, recorded at record session number 42 by the orchestra of Glenn Miller.
He was very generous, but Glenn was, in a sense, more the captain of the ship, in that he liked for his men to look neat, have their hair cut, their suits pressed. He was very much concerned with the cosmetic angle of the band.
And while trumpeter Zeke Zarchi was having his thoughts of Glenn Miller, another trumpet player, Charlie Spivak, with whom Miller had worked in the old Dorsey Brothers band, was also reflecting on Miller's generosity, helping the Spivak band get started that fall of 1940.
Glenn Miller was the man that was responsible for the whole thing, Chuck. He is the guy that guardian angel, you know. He put up all the money for me so that I could get started, and he put me into a place called the Glen Island Casino, which at that time and still is in New Rochelle, New York, and that was sort of the cradle spot for all the bands And that was the starting off place, and I was fortunate enough to be able to go in there, and with Glenn's help, of course, that made it possible for me to make some kind of name for myself.
And Glenn Miller's record session number 42 continued, from Yester Thoughts to Shadows on the Sand, Goodbye Little Darling Goodbye, to Falling Leaves. September 3rd, 1940, RCA Victor Studios, New York City. The conclusion of recording session number 42 for Glenn Miller, Memory Maker.
Honky-tonky village in Texas, there's a guy who plays the best piano by far. He can play piano any way that you like it, but the way he likes it best is 8 to the bar. When he plays, it's a ball. He is the daddy of them all. The people gather round when he gets on the stand. Then when he plays, he gets a hand. Rhythm he beats, puts the cats in a trance. Nobody there, bothers to dance. And when he jams with the bass and guitar, they holler, oh, beat me daddy, 8 to the bar. A plink, plunking on the keys. A riff, well, they're riffing out with ease. And when he jams with the bass and guitar, they holler, oh, come on and beat me, Daddy, 8 to the bar.
Guitarist Jack Lathrop singing Beat Me Daddy, 8 to the Bar, featuring Chummy McGregor on piano. And while Glenn Miller's music had a happy, carefree sound...
He actually ran your life for you, there's no question about that. He was the head man, and nothing went on but what he didn't okay it or turn it down. He himself ran the whole thing, and you could learn a lot about business from him too.
Paul Tanner, remembering record session number 43, September the 12th, 1940, New York City. Remembering the man, Glenn Miller, memory maker. October the 11th, 1940, recording session number 44. Glenn Miller was adding new musicians and experimenting with a singing group known as the Modernaires, whose spokesman was Hal Dickinson.
The first time that we did anything for Glenn was a theme for Martin Block called Make Believe Ballroom, and that's where Glenn first got the idea that he wanted to have a quartet with the band.
Ballroom, come on, children, let's dance, let's dance.
The Moderneers recorded Make Believe Ballroom Time of the Glenn Miller Band at session number 44. Not until session number 50 would they become a regular part of Glenn Miller's music. New musicians included trumpet playing Ray Anthony.
It was only after I arrived with Glenn Miller and watched this thing subconsciously that I said, well, you know, there's nothing abnormal about him. He's not that great looking. He doesn't play that great. He doesn't do this that great. And yet he's the leader of the number one band in the country. So why can't I do it? You know, this is all going on subconsciously. Then I used to talk to Johnny O'Leary, his road manager, and tell Johnny that someday I'm going to have my own band and I'd like to have Johnny manage it. The dumb things that a kid would do, you know. Of course, Glenn Miller heard about it the next 10 minutes, you know. But the ambition to have my own came at that time.
That certain night, the night we met, there was magic abroad in the air. There were angels dining at the Ritz, and a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square.
Nightingale sang in Berkeley Square. Another of the four sides made it session number 44. Through the rest of October, the band would be broadcasting nightly from the Pennsylvania Hotel and the CBS studios in New York. It was during this time that Billy May was added to the band. His influence would soon be heard in the music of Glenn Miller, Memory Maker. Thank you. Arranger trumpeter Billy May would make his first record in the Glenn Miller Band the 8th of November, 1940, at recording session number 45.
Glenn offered me a job, and again, the bread was so good that I had to take it. But and I worked there for 2 years. But I really enjoyed playing in the Barnett Band more than I enjoyed playing with Glenn Miller.
Like a pretty purple veil, thereby hangs a tale. I found you, and the mountains that surround you are the wall I built around you along the Santa Fe Trail.
Of the 71 recording sessions under the name Glenn Miller, that was number 45, producing four sides, including Along the Santa Fe Trail. This is Chuck Cecil with a chronological display of Glenn Miller's music and commentary by the men and women who worked to help Glenn Miller become a memory maker.
Yes, my darling daughter.
Yes, My Darling Daughter, one of just two sides made at Glenn Miller recording session number 46, New York City, November the 15th, 1940.
Anything that we did, Chuck, at that time was so well received by the whole public because, as you know, at that time, everybody was completely band conscious. It was a real big deal to get on coast-to-coast shots, you know, and then, of course, when you'd hit the road, why, everybody that heard the band had to come see you in person.
Tex Beneke, remembering the recording sessions and the long-run nightly broadcasts and the in-person performances of Glenn Miller, Memory Maker. Time No See Baby from a recording session number 47, Victor Studios, New York City, the orchestra of Glenn Miller, a good training ground for future leaders like Ray Anthony.
He taught me discipline, he taught me organization, he taught me all the kind of things that that band stood for because that was Glenn Miller, you see. His music was so organized, his presentation was so organized, it was so disciplined, everybody had clean, pressed uniforms. This kind of thing.
The music and the memories made at session number 47 by Glenn Miller, Memory Maker. For the moment, away from the recording studios for a radio broadcast by Glenn Miller, air checks from December 7th, 1940 found a new opening theme song. Conflict between radio stations and ASCAP cause Slumber Song to temporarily replace Moonlight Serenade.
On a Saturday evening, it's dance music by one of the nation's ace band leaders, arrangers, composers, and trombonists. Sent your way from a gay festive setting of the Café Rouge in Hotel Pennsylvania, New York City. We mean the incomparable music of Glenn Miller and his orchestra, and we hope you'll join us in this dance period and share in a bit of the fun of music that we're about to present to you. Glenn Miller's Moonlight Serenaders.
A new theme and new arrangements for trumpeter Billy May.
Mine were just things like Daisy May and Long Tom Mama, Friday Afternoon, tunes like that. They were, as I said, I was working most of the time as a trumpet player, but I didn't want to I didn't want to get rusty arranging, so every once in a while I write a chart. And Glenn used to sign the songs he needed, the pop songs and everything. He would assign them to the regular arrangers because that was their job. And he just kept telling me, write an original, write originals.
Daisy May, opening the Glenn Miller broadcast, was a composition credited to Arletta May.
All the things in the Glenn Miller thing that come out and have, it has my first wife's name on them, Arletta May, as a composer. This was because I had a contractual confliction there, and rather than putting some artificial name on it, I put it in my wife's name. And So there are quite a few originals in the Glenn Miller catalog that I did and have her name on.
Disguise my love. Though I know too much love may curb the fire, yet there I go, led astray by my desire. There's no golden rule to guide a fool in love. I tell my heart, be careful, or you'll find that you dream alone. I'm wise, it's true, what good does it do? My heart has a mind of its own. There I go, spilling all the dreams I knew. And there I go, thrillingly in love with you. Don't know if you care, darling, but there I go.
There I Go, and Billy May's Daisy May, a sampling of the radio broadcast made from the Pennsylvania Hotel the night of December 7th, 1940, by the orchestra of Glenn Miller, Memory Maker. Thank you. From Glenn Miller recording session number 48 came Anvil Chorus. Arranged by Jerry Gray, it was recorded in two parts featuring Mo Pertle on drums, Billy May on trumpet. At the same session, Miller was assigned to cover on Bluebird Artie Shaw's hit, A Frenzy. Bill Finnegan arranged a new tempo, assigned the trumpet solo there to Johnny Best.
Most of my stuff in that band were very slow tunes, like I had a thing on Frenzy, an open, there are two trumpet solos on that, one muted solo with Dale McNichol, and then I had a, an open trumpet solo on that. Frenzy, concluding the seventh hour of our 12-hour remembrance of Glenn Miller, Memory Maker.